Buongiorno a tutti. On behalf of the organizers and the co-chairs of this session, I'd like to give you a very warm Parma welcome. My name is Maurice Whelan. I work for the European Commission's Joint Research Center. I'm head of the Chemical Safety and Alternative Methods Unit, and I'm also responsible for the EU Reference Laboratory for Alternatives to Animal Testing, better known as ECFAM to some of you. We've come together here for the session on human health risk assessment science. We're here to reflect on advances in toxicology, in exposure science, in epidemiology, and many related areas. And we really want to reflect on how these advances can impact risk assessment going forward, and also importantly, how it can influence the risk management decisions we make and how we communicate them. And you know, in light of these advances, some are calling for a revolution in the way we do business. Others prefer to talk about a natural evolution. And many talk about paradigm shifting. And I often reflect sometimes that paradigm shifting, you know, paradigm shifting hurts. It hurts the head in the sense of trying to get your head around all these scientific advances and understanding them and their implications. It hurts the wallet in the sense that implementing advances in institutions requires big investment in people and processes. And very importantly, it also sometimes hurts the emotions. We're not very quick to leave behind traditions and the way we've been doing things. So this session is comprehensive and extensive. It'll run this morning, through this afternoon, and through tomorrow morning. We've got many different talks covering concepts, tools, and applications and case studies. So we hope you'll stick with us through the duration. And you know, to keep you engaged and off your emails, we've really tried to design an interesting and varied program for you. Never a dull moment, I hope. Of course, we've got top-notch speakers. We've got panel discussions. We've got some summary talks. And of course, you've got highly competent co-chairs to steer you through the proceedings. So a couple of practical points for you. The app will be open for you to post questions, as yesterday. But there'll also be chance after each talk to also ask questions in person, which we'd actually prefer, if you'd maybe introduce yourself and your affiliation. We'll also be asking you a polling question later in the morning. I won't tell you what it is. And then we'll also ask you that tomorrow to see if you've changed your mind during the proceedings. So that's it from me. I wish us all every success in this journey, and I'm sure it'll be find it stimulating and inspiring. So I'd like to hand over to my co-chair, Guillaume Desize.
Thank you. Thank you, Maurice. So I will be co-chairing with Maurice this morning. My name is Guillaume Desize. I'm the head of regulated products at EFSA. So I'm not an expert in the field of human health risk assessment, but I'm definitely a big customer of all the knowledge we will hear about this morning. As Maurice said, we have three talks this morning, about 30 minutes, including questions, specific questions on the talk to clarify things. The higher level questions would be best left for the panel discussion that we have later on. And the questions in the app, but even better if you feel bold enough to stand up and have a lively discussion in the room, of course, better. That said, we can get started. Our first speaker today is Dr. Michael Zigrist from the Institute of Environmental Decision in Zurich, Switzerland. professor of consumer behavior, and Michael will be talking about how simple heuristics influence lay people's risk perceptions. Michael, the floor is yours.
So thank you very much for this kind introduction and also for the invitation to talk a little bit about social science work that provides some information about people make decisions which may also be important for your field. So let's think for a minute how you make decision as a scientist. So probably you gather all evidence, you're trying to integrate the information, you may do a multi-criteria analysis, whatever is in your toolbox, but you are doing it in a very scientific, rational way. Now translate this into your daily life. Then your decision would look like, doesn't seem to move here. So if you translate your scientific way of making decisions in your daily life, it would look like this here. So you would gather all the evidence, you would integrate the evidence, and then you would make a decision. So you see it in this cartoon here. In order to say good evening, you would see or decide, is the other a threat? Is it a risk? Are there mitigation factors, like the black guy is having a FedEx envelope, which may be an indication that there is no risk to say good evening. So it would be a very detailed way of making decisions. And of course, this is not the way we are doing decisions in our daily life. We make rather quick decisions, which means point this? Yeah. Okay. So this. So here you see the two modes of thinking which has been proposed to explain how we make decisions in various areas. So you've got a system that has been labeled as experiential system, the other one as analytic system. And as a scientist, you are using your analytic system to make decisions. So therefore, you are basing your reasoning on logical connections. The reality is encoded in abstract symbols, words, you are using numbers. You are justification, your conclusions by logic and evidence. That's how an analytic system works like. However, if you are doing your decision in your daily life, then you would be overwhelmed if you would rely on the analytic system only. So therefore, in order to survive in your daily environment, we have to make quick decisions. We are relying on the experiential system, in other words, to make decisions. So we use associations, we use images, we use metaphors, we use narratives. So therefore, the experiential system differs in a number of aspects from the analytic system. There is no way to say that one system is bad and the other one is good. That's not what I'm trying to say. I'm trying to say here that if you as a scientist are making a decision and you're relying on the analytic system, and lay people, consumers, may make the same decisions based on the experiential system, then there may be some differences, and there may be also some difficulties to understand why experts came to completely different conclusions that are at odds with the images, with the narratives people have. So therefore, I think this idea that we are using two different systems in order to make decisions may be helpful in order to understand some differences between lay people's and experts' decision making. And you as an expert, you may use the analytical system in order to make decision in your field, but I'm sure you are using the experiential system in many, many situations. And I usually ask the same questions and I always receive the same answer. I usually ask, when you've married, have you used the analytic system to make your decision? So have you done a multi-criteria analysis? So you listed all the criteria that are important for you in your spouse, and then you have weighted all dimensions, and then you aggregated them, and you had a single number which then guided your decision to say, well, that's the person I should marry. I haven't met such a person so far, so if someone has really used the experiential system, please contact me in the break, so I would be really interested in how you did it. Okay. So the heuristics are very important when it comes to using the experiential system. And what's a heuristic? A heuristic means that we are not using the criteria that may be important or the best information in order to make a decision, but we are using the information that comes easily into your mind. So in other words, if you do not have any access to the internet, if you are asked what's the risk of various hazards, you may think of concrete examples where people were harmed by a given hazard. And if you have a hard time to think of concrete examples, then you may say, well, that's probably not the hazard I have to be concerned about. And if you can easily think of concrete examples where people were harmed, you may conclude, well, that's probably a hazard I should be concerned about. Of course, this line of reasoning may result in useful decisions, but it may also result in distorted results, especially if the media, for example, report in a biased way. If a hazard is in the news for a long time, and you can easily think of concrete examples because you have stored many such examples in your memory. So therefore, heuristics may not be always bad, but they may result in distorted decisions. And one of these, or one example of such a heuristic that may result in biased decision is shown here on this slide. So we asked here people first, what is the effect evoked by nuclear power? Is this very negative, is it neutral, or is it positive? And afterwards we asked them about benefits, about risk of food irradiation, about acceptance, and we assumed that people use their effect evoked by nuclear power in order to assess food irradiation. And this is exactly what happened. If we look at the correlations here, then we had correlations around 0.3, 0.4 almost, which shows that people used very simple heuristics. They used information that's available. It's not relevant for the question asked. That's not the point here. The point is people are using sometimes information that comes easily to their mind, which they think is relevant for answering a question. Another heuristic that people very often use is natural is good. So they basically assume that nature is better than things done by humans. And in the West, at least, nature is perceived as something that needs to be preserved. It's perceived as something that's sacred. And there is, I'm not saying this is not good, but it may have some unintended consequences if people are relying on this natural is better heuristic. I'll skip this slide here. So the importance of naturalness can be seen in many various marketing activities. I mean, I could have used examples from Europe, examples from the US, but I like this one from China. You see here on the bottom line, the first all natural vegetable colored macarons, no artificial coloring or preservations added. So you see here, even if you look at these very unnatural looking sweets here, the aspect of naturalness seems to be very important. It's emphasized, and this clearly shows how important naturalness is, not only for people in Europe, but also in other countries, in other continents. Now, let me quickly summarize an experiment where we showed how this question whether something is caused by nature or humans may have a huge impact on people's perception. So we came up here with two kind of headline types of information. One was a human-caused event where we told people on an oil platform a large amount of oil leaked into the sea. As a result of this oil spill, more than 1,200 birds have been killed. So one group of participants received this information. The other group received information on the bottom. There it read, due to natural oil seeps at the bottom of the sea, oil leaked through channels and cracks in rock formation, a large amount of oil leaked into the sea. As a result of this oil spill, more than 1,200 birds have been killed. So again, people were randomly assigned to one of these two conditions, and we asked them a couple of questions. And of course, you could say, well, severeness, there may be a reason why one should be perceived as more severe than the others, because the human-caused events may be coming on top of the nature-caused events. So therefore, we came up with the question where we said, well, it's very hard to think of a rational reason why people should respond differently in these two conditions. And this question was, how much do the birds suffer? And I hope you agree with me, it doesn't matter to birds whether they are killed by oil that is the result of a human-caused event or the result of a nature-caused event. So from a rational point of view, I think it would be very difficult to argue that here a different response could be justified. But this is exactly what we found. We see here a direct effect from the manipulation on animal suffering, which means that people who were informed that it's a natural caused event, they perceived less animal suffering compared with the other group. And what is the reason for this? The reason of this is the effect experienced. So in other words, when we were informing people that the event was caused by humans, they had much more negative effect compared with the situation when it was caused by nature, and due to this different level of affect, the animal suffering was assessed in different ways. So therefore, we can easily explain why people react differently in the two situations, but nevertheless, from a normative point of view, I think it's very difficult to defend here different responses for the question of animal suffering. Well, very similar results have been observed in the field of gene technology. Here we use the following example. In the first scenario, we provided participants the following information. A new corn variety was gene technically modified that can better cope with stress situations such as droughts. A gene from a bacterium was used for the genetically modification of the new corn variety. And this new breed results in a yield increase of 6 to 10% with unchanged production cost. For the second group, we used very similar information here, but we mentioned here that this was a result of conventionally breeding technology. But the result was exactly the same. And here also the question we were interested in was, do people perceive the benefit differently in the two conditions? I mean, again, if you say, well, I'm against gene technology for this or that reason, shouldn't really influence here the benefit assessment for the farmer. So in other words, you would expect that people come up with similar assessments in both conditions. And again, people were randomly assigned to one out of these two conditions here. You see here the results. On the top, you see how to evaluate from the standpoint of the farmer the decision to plant this new corn variety. And you see here a substantial differences between gene technology and conventional breeding technology. So in the case of gene technology, it was perceived in a much more negative way compared with the conventional breeding condition. Now, how are the benefits assessed? You see this in the bottom part of the slide here. How important you assess these additional revenues for a farmer who solely cultivates corn. And you see here the GM group perceived this benefit less positive compared with the conventional group. We had an additional study in which we even asked them, well, if you think about the farmer earns 10,000 Swiss francs more, and you observe the same difference. So in other words, people thought that 10,000 Swiss francs are less valuable when it's the result of gene technology compared with conventional technology. And of course, this poses a challenge for a technology like gene technology. If people discount the benefits of a technology because it's the result of a technology, then it's very difficult to convince people that the benefits justify the technology. So we are basically in a catch-22 situation. Again, here the question is, how can we explain that people react differently to GM technology and to conventional breeding technology? So it's a little bit a busy slide here, so I suggest that you just focus on the bottom, on the figure here. And there you see on the what's labeled as A here, you see basically what I just told you. So the manipulation had an impact on perceived importance of additional revenues for the farmer. And in the part B of this figure, you see the factors that may influence it. And this is perceived naturalness of corn. So in other words, gene technology is perceived as extremely unnatural by people, whereas conventional breeding technology is perceived as rather natural. And this difference in perceived naturalness, first of all, evokes different levels of affect. So unnatural perception results in negative affect, and both perceived unnaturalness and negative affect then explains why people react differently when it comes to the importance of additional revenues for farmers. So again, a simple heuristic that is applied may result here in biased assessments of technology. So another heuristic that people may apply when assessing healthiness of products may be that they are thinking, well, if some products are free from certain ingredients, then it must be more healthy. I mean, why would it be labeled otherwise? I mean, there must be some benefits that some substances are missing. And we did here a study in which we had palm oil, free from palm oil, free from gluten, free from milk sugar, free from gene technology. And I just present two examples because basically across all four free from labels, we observed very similar results. And they had basically unbranded products, here chocolate, for example, one with the free from label, the other one without, and they had to say, well, do they perceive the two products as similar healthy, or do they perceive one product as more healthy compared with the others? And we collected data in four different countries, in the UK, France, Poland, and Sweden. Here you see the free from palm oil products, and you see here the products with free from label were perceived as more healthy for all products, be it chocolate, be it fat, be it a kind of Nutella. So therefore, the free from label had a clear effect. How does it look for gene technology? You see it here, even stronger effects, but in the same direction. So the chocolate that has a free from label on it is perceived as much more healthy compared with the ones without such a label. So therefore, also here we see heuristical processing of the information has a strong impact. So I'm going to skip the next two slides and come to kind of some reasons for lack of acceptance of gene technology. I mean, there is a long or a couple of decades already research going on in order to explain why is there a lack of acceptance of gene technology. And certainly, trust may have an impact, lack of trust in the food industry, also partially in science, that may be responsible for part of the lack of acceptance of gene technology. We already mentioned benefit perception, certainly an important driver for the acceptance of gene technology, and we have to admit that if we look at people or consumers in the West, then gene technology does not provide really tangible benefits to this type of consumers. I mean, the food does not taste better, it's not cheaper, it doesn't have any advantage to consumers, so therefore you cannot blame them that they do not want to buy this stuff because there is single no benefit. But we've seen before, even if a product has a benefit, then we may take into account that the benefits may be discounted because people discount the benefits of gene technology, which shows how difficult it may be to demonstrate to consumers benefits if there are benefits. What we should also consider here are moral values. I think part of the discussion about acceptance of gene technology is a moral-driven discussion. And the reason for this is that gene technology is viewed by many people as very unnatural. They think it's very unnatural, so people think this is completely different from conventional breeding technology. We've also seen in other studies that gene technology applications evoke disgust, and that people who very quickly show disgust reactions, they are less likely to accept gene technology compared with other people. So this idea of inserting genes may have some impact on the disgust reaction. And why is it perceived as unnatural? It's perceived as unnatural because there is a contamination by human processing. So let me quickly summarize in my last slide here the important points. And I will here focus on gene technology, but I think many of the points are important for other food technology as well. I mean, first of all, I would like to come back between the difference between the experiential and the analytical system, and consumer decisions are often the result of the experiential system. Therefore, consumers, lay people may come to different conclusions compared to the experts because the decision system they are using is different. Now, what will not work in order to increase acceptance of gene technology? And I emphasize this because this is what I often hear by people who want to increase acceptance of gene technology, that they say, well, just provide additional knowledge and demonstrate that there are no risks associated with gene technology. I think this is not going to work because there is very little correlation between knowledge related to gene technology and acceptance of gene technology, so the correlations are so small that I wouldn't expect here higher acceptance if people would know more about gene technology. And then the risk may be important, but if you do not have any benefits, then people are not interested in risk to begin with because the benefits that are needed to accept the technology are lacking. So what could work? First of all, a technology needs to provide tangible benefits to consumers, then they are more likely to accept the technology. And if you think about gene technology specifically, then we may demonstrate that there is a moral issue involved with it when it comes to malnutrition, that gene technology could provide here a solution. So in other words, we should kind of change this moral discussion from it's an unnatural thing to it may provide benefits for humans who are in need of the benefit provided by gene technology. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. De Grist, for this very interesting and very well-timed presentation to frame the day, to give us some perspective about how to think about new methodology, perception, acceptability of new methodology, also acceptability of laboratory animal suffering. You had a slide. Do we have any questions from the room? Because I don't see anything in the app yet. Yes, in the middle. There. Microphone is coming to you.
Thank you. Thanks. Can you discuss about the possibility that the age influences, of course, the perception a lot? So it could be good to do some work on the children's school to make the GT technology be accepted?
Well, I mean, education never does any harm. Does it result in higher acceptance of gene technology? I have some doubts. Because this is still the idea, if people know how something works, then they are going to accept it. I mean, you're accepting your cell phones, do you know how it works? Probably not. At least I do not know how my cell phone works. But that's not important to me because it delivers so many benefits that I'm using it. And even people who are concerned about some negative sides of the technology are using it because the benefits are so overwhelming. So therefore, trying to get gene technology accepted by let people play with doing their own gene technology at home, I'm not really sure whether this is going to work. I think it needs to provide some clear, tangible benefits, and then people are also willing to accept some risk, because we are not that risk averse that we would never accept any risk. I mean, in our daily life, we are accepting a lot of risk, but there are always clear benefits to us which bring us to accepting these risks.
Thank you. Do we have another question in the room? Yes, gentlemen. If you can introduce yourself briefly.
Good morning. My name is John O'Brien. I'm just reflecting on the challenges that our System 1 and System 2 are being presented with. We're bombarded with sound bites, with Twitter feed and so on. Is that likely to generate an increasing challenge for risk communicators, where we want to make people think about food, we want to make people think about risk and to take responsibility for some of the management themselves. But if they're conflicted by the temptation of taking a lazy decision, then we won't get them to where we want to go effectively. So do you think there's an easier way of improving risk communication?
Mm-hmm. I think you need to be motivated. So therefore, I'm not sure whether the new social media have completely changed how we make the decision. I have some doubts. So I think we still use very often the experiential system today, and we used it also 20 years ago for most decisions, the experiential system, because it's a very easy to use system. You can make very quick decisions, and you need to be motivated to use the analytical system. I agree that with the social media, maybe the heuristical cues or the information you are using for making the experiential system may be different. So therefore, it certainly has an impact on risk communication. But I do not think that it has an impact on the frequency of using one or the other system. So therefore, I think there it hasn't much changed. But of course, it's a challenge to provide the information, because whereas maybe 20 years ago you had a hard time to get the information you needed, now you have so much information, and the task is now to filter out the information that is relevant for your task. So therefore, the task we are solving has changed, fully agree with that, but I still think most of the time, and this has been true probably for all human history, we are relying on the experiential system in most of the time.
Thank you very much. Time is up. Let's move on. Thank you, Dr. Zegrist. And let me introduce our second speaker, Dr. Ellen Mantus. Dr. Mantus is a scholar and director of risk assessment on the board on environmental studies and toxicology at the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering and Medicine. And Dr. Mantus will be talking to us this morning about using 21st century science to improve risk assessment, opportunities and challenges. Dr. Mantus, the floor is yours.
Thank you, and thank you so much for the kind invitation to be here today. So I was asked to talk and give a few reflections on some National Academy reports. Before I do that, though, I'd like to just tell a little bit about my organization because it helps set the context for the reports. So, okay. There we go. So our organization was founded in 1863. It was founded to be independent of the government, to provide authoritative, objective advice on science and technology. And over the years, we've grown. We are now the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine. So we have three honorary societies and an operating arm that has six divisions and 60 boards. So I work for one of those boards, as my introduction indicated. I also work on the board on chemical sciences and technology, and I'm the director there of their Chemical Sciences Roundtable. So it's important to remember that the National Academies are not part of the government. We're not an advocacy organization, and we don't consult for for-profit entities. We're not a research organization in that we don't do original research. So what actually do we do? So one of our major activities are consensus reports. These reports are typically on matters of that are fairly difficult topics, controversial topics. What happens is the federal agencies come and ask us to do these reports, or Congress directs the agencies to come to us to ask us about the reports. We also do expert meetings and workshops. And these are opportunities to bring together people in sort of a neutral space so that they can discuss certain topics, sometimes very controversial topics. And but it's important to remember that the advice from the academies only comes from our consensus reports. We also do a lot of activities recently, especially on communication and outreach, as the plenary talks yesterday talked a lot about how important it is to communicate. And several years ago, our organization made a decision to make our reports more available to the public. So you can go on to our National Academies Press website and download any of our reports for free. We also are working to try to make our reports accessible to various audiences. So the reports that, the main report I'm going to talk about is our most recent report, but I need to mention the reports that came before it to set some context for that, the recent report. So a report in 2007 was toxicity testing in the 21st century, and this report really set the stage. It put forth a vision in which the toxicology and toxicity testing would be carried out using in vitro high-throughput methods and computational tools based on human biology rather than the traditional animal testing. And while this vision certainly had been talked about before our report came out, our report really mobilized our federal agencies into putting a lot of energy and resources into implementing the vision. Years later, the report, sort of the companion report for toxicity testing, was Exposure Science in the 21st Century. This report capitalized on all the new technologies, sensors, and computational tools to really expand the depth and breadth of exposure assessment to try to make it more integrative with toxicology and epidemiology. So the report I'm going to focus on, though, today is using 21st century science. So the several agencies, which you'll see on this slide, came to us and said, we know that we aren't at the stage where the vision has been implemented, but we certainly have generated a lot of data, and can't we use this data to help us do risk assessment better? And so what you see on your right are the chapters of the report. We talked a lot about the advances in the science since the publication of the previous reports, although we haven't done yet, at least a report on epidemiology in the 21st century. We did think it was important to talk about the advances in epidemiology. And I'm not going to talk about the advances there, and we also talked a bit about the challenges in each of the different disciplines. And I think one of the cross-cutting challenges in the discipline, I think is no surprise to anyone, that it's the generation of all the data and the management of that data. So creating the databases to handle it, curating the databases, and also integrating the data. And I'll come back to that topic in a minute. So what I'm going to talk about are really the applications that the committee discussed in the report. So, okay, I am pushing the button. There we go, applications, let's move on. Okay, so what the committee discussed was and thought about was anywhere in the risk assessment paradigm that we could use and integrate the new technologies. So whether it was in hazard identification, dose response, or exposure assessment, or even in risk characterization, where can we integrate new technologies? So one of the areas I think is probably no surprise to anyone, and is one that's been brought up time and time again, of where to integrate the new technologies is in priority setting. So that you would use computational tools to generate exposure estimates. You can use in vitro sort of high throughput tools to generate data on toxicity. You would look where there's an intersection between high toxicity and high exposure predictions and prioritize those chemicals for testing. So as far as application, so while our report was going on in the U.S., they passed a law called the Frank-Lautenberg Act. And what this was actually an amendment to our Toxic Substances Control Act, which regulates how we look at existing and new chemicals and manage them. And they directed EPA in this act to reduce and replace basically the use of vertebrate animals to the extent possible. So it was really motivating and pushing and really putting into action the idea of replacing animals. So also part of this act is that EPA was directed to come up with a strategic plan to actually do this, to put into place this idea of replacing the animals. So why am I mentioning this for priority setting? So one of the things that the EPA has to do now is actually prioritize chemicals, 20 chemicals in a given time frame for testing. And as part of their strategic plan, that they actually came out with their strategic plan in June, which was pretty broad sweeping and talked a bit about where all these different alternative methods can be input into the TSCA process, but priority setting is really one of the first places in which they're going to start implementing and putting into place these alternative methods. And my understanding is the guidance for doing so is literally about to come out. So within the next couple of weeks, if it even hasn't come out in the last couple of days. So. Okay, I feel like this is a hazing experience. So chemical assessment is another area where the committee felt very strongly could be, we could utilize a technique called read-across, where you're taking data from an analog that has a lot of data and using it that data to derive health values for a chemical that doesn't have a lot of data, so a data-poor chemical. And this has obviously, I think, been used a little bit more extensively outside the U.S., but hasn't been utilized that greatly in the U.S., at least as part of its regulatory frameworks. And so the committee thought it could be implemented more so in the regulatory framework. And one of the things that is a concern, and it's even a concern in priority setting, is this idea that we're going to miss something or something is going to be mischaracterized. Because certainly with read-across, we know that there are structures and chemicals that have very similar structures, but they have very different biological activity. So one of the things the committee thought was that as part of this and adding another step in sort of the read-across is implementing some of the high-throughput tools or sort of in vivo toxicogenomic studies, short-term studies, that can help give greater confidence that the analog and the chemical of interest have similar biological activity. So where is this being implemented? So in the U.S., we have something called the Superfund program that is there for helping to clean up hazardous waste sites. And as everybody knows, at a hazardous waste site, there are usually chemicals there that don't have a lot of data to be able to figure out how to clean the site up. So what they have is they generate what they call provisional peer-reviewed toxicity values. And these are, as I said, chemicals that don't have a lot of data, especially not what we would consider tier one data. So where is this? So the EPA, as part of generating these numbers now, use what they call expert-driven read-across, and they use all the chemistry and the pharmacokinetic data and any toxicity data to help them identify analogs for these chemicals where they can use the analog data. And I've just listed on the one side the chemicals for which they've used this expert-driven read-across. And clearly this was actually going on before our report, but the activity picked up much more dramatically after our report, and there is a goal to be doing at least 12 chemicals a year, although we're yet waiting on the 2018 values. So other places in which they're implementing some of the new technology is in our endocrine disruptor screening program. That is what it sounds like, where chemicals are evaluated for their endocrine disrupting activity. It's a tiered testing system, and as part of that tiered testing system, there is something called the uterotrophic assay, which is meant to evaluate estrogen binding activity and estrogen activity. And now there are alternatives for doing that assay. You can use a combination of in vitro and computational tools to substitute for that assay. And in our pesticide registration program, they're also looking to replace the acute toxicity test with alternatives. The other area that the committee discussed was in site-specific assessment. This is something where you have a spill and you need information quickly. So they felt that the new techniques and tools would be very helpful because what you have to do is identify what's there, figure out the toxicity of what's there, and think about, too, the mixtures and the toxicity of the mixtures. And the committee felt that with both the targeted and non-targeted testing, that would help give you information on what's there, and the new tools such as in vitro techniques and other new ways of evaluating toxicology could help give information on the hazard of what's there. And also with the new tests, it's easier to actually look at mixtures. So understanding what the cumulative effect of the exposure might be. So where is this been tried? So unfortunately, we had a spill in a river in West Virginia in 2014, and not much was known about the chemical, the major chemical that was spilled into the river. It was a chemical called methyl cyclohexane methanol. And what happened was they really didn't know what to do. When the spill happened, of course, they put everybody off the water system because this chemical was spilled so that it affected the water system for the city. And so one of the things that our National Toxicology Program did was start using some of the new techniques to look at what the hazard might be associated with exposure. So they did some structure activity relationships, the in vitro assays, and assays in C. elegans and zebrafish, and also a toxicogenomic study in rats to help in some ways demonstrate how these new techniques could be very helpful in situations where you have a spill, you have to generate information quickly when you don't know that much about the chemical. So the last area I just want to mention is the assessment of new chemistries. So this is very similar to the chemical assessment. This is the idea that you have a manufacturer who's producing chemicals that they don't know anything about, really the toxicity. You could think of running the chemicals through in vitro toxicity screens that could then allow you to use computational tools to figure out what might be the use or emission rate for these chemicals and try to develop scenarios. It might also help tell the manufacturer what chemical to proceed with. So challenges associated with these. So one of the big challenges, and I think these challenges, even though it's in a report that's now over a year old, I think these are very relevant today. And it's something, as I said, we heard about yesterday, we heard about this morning, and one is about communicating. And if we can't communicate the strengths and limitations of these techniques, they're not going to be accepted. And it's getting, I think one of the things that was said yesterday that I thought was interesting was, I think it was the science is increasingly mistrusted, I think were the exact words. And I think one of the problems is that our techniques and our science is moving so far ahead of where it's easy to explain to someone that doesn't have a science background, that it's making it difficult to get acceptance for these techniques. So another area is this idea of data analysis, interpretation, and integration. And the committee felt really strongly that insufficient attention has been paid to this, and that integrating all these various streams of data, we're generating lots of data, but a lot of times we don't really know what to do or how to integrate and put all these pieces together. And the committee felt very strongly about that and suggested a research agenda for trying to deal with that. And they suggested developing case studies of decision-making and data availability scenarios, testing those case studies with multidisciplinary panels, and cataloging the evidence and evaluation decisions so that you could come back to it and sort of iterate and improve on how you're integrating and interpreting the evidence. And the other thing is to spend some time in thinking about the statistical tools needed to integrate. And again, it's interesting that in the reports that I've been involved with for the last couple of years at least, the big emphasis is really on this idea of multidisciplinary approaches and scientists across various disciplines coming together and working together. And it's certainly going to be needed to ensure that the full potential of the science is realized. So, I'm going to switch subject for my last few minutes. Not really switch subjects, but kind of expand on this topic. And the idea that we know that these new techniques and tools are going to be really helpful, I think, for filling data gaps and telling us how things work and the mechanisms for adverse outcomes. But I think it's also going to have some other dramatic effects. In this, and I'm going to talk about the human microbiome, and you're probably saying, what does the human microbiome have to do with risk assessment? Well, in all these new tools and techniques that we have, so the omics generation, the sequencing generation, we have come to learn a lot about the human microbiome. And I'm defining the human microbiome as all the microorganisms that live in and on our body and their genes in the surrounding environment. And usually when we think about microbes, especially when you think about food, is you think about contamination. But in this case, we're thinking about good microbes that actually live and help us with being healthy, actually. So one of the things that we've really learned in the last few years is that the microbiome is very important to our health. And so that if you have perturbations in your microbiome, and most of the research has gone on with the gut microbiome, is that you can have adverse health outcomes. And there's a lot of links now to different perturbations in the microbiome and adverse health effects. And even things like you can kind of figure that the gut microbiome, if you have perturbations, you might have connected to inflammatory bowel disease, but there are other things like neurological effects and autoimmune diseases and disorders that are now being connected to disturbances in the microbiome. And so we also know that the microbiome can affect the chemicals. We know that from drug research, that the microbiome can metabolize chemicals and have an effect. So you start thinking about this and you start thinking, well, if you have perturbations in the microbiome, there could be problems, and we know the microbiome can metabolize chemicals. Is this a problem that we're not thinking about the microbiome when we do risk assessment? We don't explicitly consider the microbiome, and are we missing adverse effects or mischaracterizing adverse effects because we aren't taking that into consideration? So two federal agencies came to us and asked us to develop an overall research strategy for looking at the interactions between the microbiome and environmental chemicals and the implications of those interactions for human health risk assessment. And about 8 months or so ago, we released this report, Environmental Chemicals, Human Microbiome and Risk Assessment, a research strategy. And so why do we think that this research could be really groundbreaking? One of the things, as we know, is that there are very big variations. Not, there are individual variations between our microbiome, but there are big differences between populations. And could these differences in the populations explain why we're seeing different effects in epidemiology studies? Because a lot of times epidemiology studies are being discounted, especially right now. They're sort of under attack in the United States because they have inconsistent results. We're not seeing the same effects in different populations when we have chemical exposures. And could the reason be that they have different microbiomes? And that would be groundbreaking if that actually turned out to be true. There are also big differences between animal microbiomes and human microbiomes. And are we missing effects by, you know, looking at, you know, using effects in animals and extrapolating those to humans? It also would, if we knew more about it, would give greater confidence in our extrapolation. And of course, as I said before, are we missing things? And one of the things about as we move to in vitro tests, this also becomes a big issue because one of the challenges has been incorporating metabolism into the in vitro assays. But that's generally, you're talking about metabolism by the liver, not the microbiome. So if we're moving more and more to in vitro tests, this is something we need to start thinking about for sure. So the three questions that the committee felt were very important to address and focus their research strategy were basically this idea of the action of the chemical on the microbiome. So can environmental chemical exposures at doses that are relevant to human exposure actually induce alterations in the human microbiome that end up causing adverse health effects? And then there's the question of how the microbiome is microbiome affects chemicals, so how does it modulate chemical exposure? And then the questions involving the variation about can the microbiome explain or help us understand individual risk and susceptibility to environmental chemicals? And then with the animal question is the variation so great that we're missing or mischaracterizing effects when we're using animal models? And are our interspecies uncertainty factors adequate for extrapolating from animals to humans? And the sort of the concluding remark regarding the study is hopefully this research that's put forth in this study will help guide the research that's conducted and help us understand the implications of the microbiome and also help us understand whether we do need to explicitly consider it in risk assessment. And so with that, I will thank and acknowledge my committees. We could not do the work that we do without our volunteers. They give their time without payment and volunteer their time and effort. And it's a very big effort for them. So we do appreciate them. This is our 21st Century Science Committee. And I believe Paolo is here, is giving a talk as well at this conference, and our microbiome committee as well. And I thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Mantas. We have time for a few questions. Thank you for keeping time for this. Do we have anything in the room? Yes, I see a hand at the far back over there, a microphone coming to you.
Ninja Reinecke, ChemTrust. Thank you very much for your very interesting talk. You said the NIS is creating the neutral space for discussing controversial topics, and I was wondering how do you go about selecting your experts that it becomes this neutral space and that you're avoiding conflicts of interest or corporate interests?
Thanks. Yeah, so that's a really important question, both in the context of both our studies and our workshops. So one of the ways that we, first of all, the way that we put together a committee and even put together our speakers for and participants in workshop is that we collect nominations from both our members of our different boards or relevant boards. They provide suggestions and nominations. We've also now actually tried to, trying to engage more the outside world in our activities, and we actually solicit nominations. People that sign up for our want information from our different boards, sign up for what we call a listserv, and that we basically send out a nomination solicitation and have people submit names. And then we go through all these different names and try to get a balance. So one of the things that we do is we, for our studies in themselves, we're very careful about eliminating conflicts of interest. And the way that the Academy defines conflicts of interest is a financial conflict of interest. That is that you have the potential to either gain or lose from the outcome of a study. And then we try to balance the biases, knowing that everybody has biases. So it's very important that we try to look to balancing those on committees and even in workshops when we gather people together. And we try to make sure that we advertise and put forth invitations to people from different sectors and for our workshops, so that we try to be very inclusive and but we also caution people that this is a forum for discussion and is not a forum for advocacy. So we try to set the ground rules very early in the discussion of our workshops that really it's not about coming to advocate for a particular position.
Thank you. We have time for one or two other questions. Do I see any requests from the floor? No. Yes, and the app is still open and can be used at any time to ask questions during the talk also. Okay. If anyone has a question who I would not see, please scream. It's a bit difficult to see all the way to the back of the room with the lighting. But I don't see anything. So with this, thank you very much, Dr. Mantus. And let me welcome our third speaker for the morning, Suzanne Benekou-Hougard. Dr. Benekou-Hougard is a senior advisor at the pesticide division of the Danish EPA and a vice chair of the scientific committee of EFSA, recently appointed. And Suzanne will talk to us about holistic approach to human health risk assessment. Is the current approach fit for purpose? Suzanne, the floor is yours.
Thanks a lot for this introduction. So, I run into problems already.
Oh, fuck.
I have a lot of clicks to do. So usually I don't use a disclaimer when I do talks. It's not that often I do talks, but when I looked at my title this time, I thought, okay, I in order to make this a bit interesting, I have to allow myself a very long leash. So this is my personal observations here. And also another disclaimer, I'm mostly talking about pesticides because that's what I know about, and it's also mostly hazard assessment, so you have to bear with that. So holistic approach and is the current approach fit for purpose? It's a bit, you can go into many directions here. First of all, it's kind of why would we need to develop all these new technologies and methods? Isn't it good enough what we already do? And then implicitly, probably not. We can always be better. But how to really integrate that is how to support this holistic approach. Maybe that's more interesting to evaluate whether our regulations today actually are fit for that purpose. So, and that's a bit of a tricky question, I thought. actually, I was really thinking, I didn't know what to say. And then for a while, I thought, okay, so how to look at this? Maybe what's the opposite of holistic? And that's compartments. Do we have compartments today? And maybe it's easier to discuss it then. And yes, we do. We already saw some of the compartments in the previous talks, hazard identification and characterization, exposure assessment, and risk characterizations. We have four distinct compartments here, and we carry out that process for single substance evaluations, compound by compound by compound. Each compound, that's a compartment. We have regulatory silos. That's also other compartments on a bigger scale. And lastly, there are geographical compartments too. So this is it's a lot of things we need to think about and integrate, I think. And this is what I'm going to talk a bit more about. So do we need it? That's the first question I ask myself. Do we really need it? What is it we want to achieve? Yeah, we want to achieve transparency and trust in safety assessment. We discussed that a lot yesterday, and maybe it's more we want to achieve informed skepticism. This was how Bernard Uhl phrased it. That's maybe more modest in a way. What is it we do in pesticides? So we have the data requirements, which are mandatory. Data requirements for all pesticides, every single substance, and you have to deliver all these studies here. You can go through them. They span from acute to repeat dose toxicity in different species. We have carcinogenicity in rats and mice, and we have teratogenicity. We have in two species too. We have reproductive toxicity, neurotoxicity, and further investigations there if there's a problem. We also have to, and that's a new kind of a new thing, we also have to scrutinize the open literature to see what other data can we find there, and then other special studies might be required. So this is that's our database now. And so do we have confidence in that, and confidence in our risk assessment? For the active substances, we get a wide range of tests, and we regulate on the basis of no observed adverse effect levels. And the reference values are also meant to cover vulnerable groups, so the whole population. And likewise on the exposure, it's reasonable upper limits for the human population. That we regulate on the basis of. And we also address risk assessment for the consumers, operators, workers, bystanders, and residents. Maybe it's not too bad. The question is, yeah, we are quite confident about this, but how safe is it? How confident are we? That's a much more difficult question. Actually, when we think a bit more about it, it relies heavily on non-human data, as you saw. It relies on in vivo data, and these are not designed to provide us with mechanistic understanding. We don't really cover multifactorial disease etiologies, like the ones we observe in a lot of the diseases we observe in humans. Co-exposures are not considered either. The reference doses are based on NOLs, and this does not allow us to quantify the uncertainty. And the deterministic reference doses, that's the same. The coverage and the uncertainty is not determined. And also, the protection goal is not well defined. So the regulations stipulates that we should ensure no harmful effects in humans. In order to do that, we have the system we have here. But this is absurd, of course. We can't do that. It's quite unfortunate that we have a protection goal like that, because every time that lay people, the public, the policymakers hear about some in vitro study or an observational study, and they see there might be something, then they get really, really disappointed because they think this is no effect, no harmful effects. But we have kind of an implicit understanding, we think, about what how is that defined, but it's certainly not expressed well, for sure. So we don't really, we're uncertain whether we really reach that protection goal. And so we need to define that better. We need to calibrate our risk assessment, and we need to then assess the chemicals. That would be the proper procedure to do. And the way to do this is nicely graphical expressed here. So we could have the ratio of the protective exposure estimate to a rodent knoll, for example. And then we could have the incidence of an adverse health effect. And we could have an acceptable risk that is properly defined here. We would, of course, this is going a bit slow. We would, of course, we will address the uncertainty around that. These ratios here, and then we could reach to the conclusion. Why is this? To reach to that critical value where we want to really make our risk assessment decisions. This would be the best way to do this. And EFSA has recently, in their guidance for uncertainty in risk assessment, really described this methodology. It's being applied now in EFSA, not for the pesticides. It was felt this was a bit too difficult, and I don't know really the reason why. But this is it's not done currently, and I have to say that this is this slide I got at the courtesy of Andy Hart, which a lot of you probably know. Okay, so we have the prescriptive data requirements, that's what we live with now. But what is it really we prescribe here? We have a lot of, it's the same studies, it's on the same species, it's the same endpoints, it's whatever we can measure in a reliable way. And if we look at one topic here, neurotoxicity. So sometimes when a pesticide is neurotoxic, then you also have, there's a concern about developmental neurotoxicity, of course. And we would, if there would be this concern, we would ask for some in vivo studies. And what is it really we prescribe here? It's a bad prescription. We prescribe the 426 OCD study. There's poor reproducibility is very difficult to interpret for the risk assessors. It's inefficient. It's very expensive. It's also insensitive. And there's even a big question mark about the relevance often. So this is clearly not helping anybody. Because in the end, it resulted in we're in this situation, even though we have these triggers, which are a bit also a bit fuzzy, that we actually don't have many data. This is not a good situation. So are there nasty surprises with the current system we have here? So this was recently looked at in a big report that EFSA had issued here. And there they looked at all the EPI studies linking exposures to pesticides and to health effects. It was a lot of studies, and they also conducted meta-analysis. And there was consistent increased risks for certain diseases here. You see them here, Parkinson's disease, childhood leukemia, type 2 diabetes, asthma, ALS, and some cancer types. And what you will also realize when you look at these health diseases, it's actually these are not typical endpoints in animal studies. So we don't, you know, we don't see childhood leukemia in mice or and Parkinson's disease in rats, really, or maybe we see something we think mirrors it a bit, but really, for a lot of these diseases, we don't really see that in rats. But still, so we see these things. But due to the due to the limitations of these types of studies, it puts the risk assessor in a really difficult situation because it doesn't allow us to come up with a conclusion with if it's just exposure to any pesticide or all the other uncertainties you have in these studies. But the concern is still there in the public, of course. And this is not fortunate. So we have to understand, is it really biologically plausible that this disease would occur if you were exposed to a given pesticide? And as EFSA has recently investigated this for two of the liabilities, so for Parkinson's disease and childhood leukemia, I would urge you to look at this. Maybe there's something you would find interesting. I will come back to it a bit more. But the prescriptive data requirements, what are really the strengths of this? Because there are this system we have now, it worked for decades. We got a lot of data. It's enormous. We don't even have to create new data. Maybe we should just look at all the data we have already. And why do we have all that data? It's due to fear of missing out. We screen everything we can measure. And then we look, and then we say this is worse, and then blah, blah, blah. And then we would regulate. So that's certainly a strength. A weakness is, of course, that we not always get the relevant data, and or even the necessary. I put that in very small letters. There are opportunities, of course, too, and I've phrased this FODU. So we have to fully optimize the data use. And this is the opportunity we have now with all this data we have. And then there are, of course, challenges, because is the system, the processes we are having now, is it really adaptive enough to integrate these new technologies? So look at the challenges, going back again to the data requirements. So are they really fit for purpose here? So maybe not. We want to change it. So, but last time, this is not a gazelle. Last time we tried to look at the data requirements for pesticides, it took 7 years to come up with this list. It's marginally different from the list we had before. And we just added a bit more animal studies just to make sure, just fear of missing out. And this was the big revision. We cannot have data requirements that are so prescriptive. And it takes 7 years to change them. We need a different system. It needs to be more flexible. Otherwise, we are just stuck with what we get now, and this is not helping us. So we need to go to that. But let's think about FODU a bit more. So we explore all these endpoints. We have one compound. This is one compartment. We look at all the we mark it. Do we have data? Do we not? Is it good enough? Blah blah blah. Good. Do it for compound 1, 2, 3, 4. Then the next issue we have in pesticides, and that's a big concern. That's metabolites. There we also do the same. We look at each metabolite and da da da. And we look at everything here, and it's often one risk assessor doing one compound, and then the next risk assessor doing the other compound, and this is, in a way, we are lost here. This is certainly not helping the integration. Because not only that, these compounds, there's also a spatial issue here. They are assessed at different time points. There can be 2 decades between these assessments, and it's only in the mind of a risk assessor, and nobody has that overview now. So clearly, we need to merge this and look at the bigger picture, and to really understand what's going on here. And I'm sorry, I'm getting really trivial here, but we need to look at the forest. Few risk assessors, they have this in their head. They have a picture of the forest because they did this for 3 decades, and they know this is noise, this is okay, this is a true effect, and blah blah blah. This is not transparent, and it's not even transparent for the risk assessors ourselves. So we really this is where we want to get to. We want to get to something more integrated and something where it's easy accessible. And I'm not convinced that just this thing about transparency that we, if we, you know, open and dump these 10,000 PDF files into the public with all that data, that this is going to help anybody? No, it's not. It's going to even confuse matters even more. We need to look at the data we have now and look at them in a smarter way. And that is, of course, to create them and get them into a format where we can actually start to see the forest. And where we also can, you know, where it seems a bit patchy here to the right here, and where we don't have a lot of data, where can we actually predict something from what we know about the forest already? And this is what would be, of course, the perfect situation. And this is where really new technologies can, I'm sorry, I got really carried away here. So if we can use these new data to bridge this and maybe make these predictions. And so this is, you know, photo is really its read across. This is the first low hanging fruit. We need to get it to work. And this is critical. And even that's a big step. We haven't seen it yet even really, you know, shown the cases here where we can integrate the new technologies and show that we can actually do this. A lot of work is going on this now. You will hear talks later today. EU ToxRisk is doing that. Center for Alternatives to Animal Testing are also supporting this a lot. There's something to look at there. There's a nice talk about from Thomas Hartung this afternoon, I think, or is it tomorrow, where we also big scale read across. But this is where we need to go to, where we can get a lot of information from the data we have already. And even if you think about it, there's so much data where we didn't see an effect in an organ system, and it's never really, it's just discarded. But there's a lot of information in that animal study. If you only see effects in the kidney, but in not any other organ system, that's also data which should be used in an efficient manner. And we can also look to medicines here, because they're really also trying to advance this with the data availability and accessibility and accessibility. This is really key, I think. Okay, so look at read across here. So we have to look at the regulations. Where do we do read across? And this, I had a brief look at it. In food contact materials and feed and flavorings, everything is good. Biocides, also good. It's a regulation from 2012. Reach, yay, here we go. We even have a guidance document. They want to do this in Reach. They have to do it also. And then we go to the pesticides. It's not even mentioned. The term, it's not there. In the regulation, in the data requirements, no. And even we have a very new regulation here for identification of endocrine disruptors. This is from this year. No mention of endocrine disruptors or read across here. And then I couldn't help. I had to understand why is this not a concept you would integrate in a modern regulation. Oh, but that's the reason. The reason is that actually the pesticide regulation, because it's linked to that, and that's from 2009, and there we didn't do that. So we can't do it now either.
Issues remaining, and quite understandably, risk assessors are hesitant to use.
And that's it's just not okay. And it's even worse than that. When you think about it, it's awful. Because what is it we want to do with the when we identify the endocrine disruptors? We have some criteria here. We have to observe an adverse effect in an intact organism. We have to look for the mode of action and also the consequence here. So we need animal data, and we need, of course, mode of action data. This is what we have seen the recent guidance from EFSA, and they have developed they tell us how to do that and how to what data we need. to address the issue, and it refers largely to, of course, to the OECD conceptual framework for endocrine disrupting chemicals, and we get level 2 data for the mode of action, and for pesticides out there we have to go to level 5 all the time. There's just no way around that. We need the most expensive and most the gold standard of animal studies. So we do this usual exercise that the risk assessors always do. We assess the endocrine disruptive properties. There are certain studies we will look more carefully about. We will look at androgen and estrogen and thyroid and steroidogenesis. We do it for compound 1, and then we do the normal business, compound 2, compound 3. And this everything is as it should be. But if we really look at the data, and we have this picture, and if you notice here, these compounds, they don't even have a similar toxophore. I didn't put that in, I had that before. But these are just different compounds. The picture, it looks the same, kind of. But then we get compound 4, and there's a big question mark. Do we lack data on AGD or not? There's some signals in the mode of action. Do we really go and ask? We already have a 2-generation study. We always have that. Do we really need the extended 1-generation study here? And it looks like a duck. It walks like a duck. Is it a duck? That's what you have to convince the regulator about. Is this a duck or not? And how can we do that? And there I have to advocate adverse outcome pathways. Because we get all these data now for the pesticides, we have an obligation to organize them in a manner that they can be used again also for read across. I just took a very popular example here, but this is what we should do. We should make adverse outcome pathways from these very robust data we will get now, and we should do it right away. Maybe we already have them here. But this is really urgent, and it has been done at the OECD. I looked at this yesterday at the wiki page, and this is the different AOPs that would support identifying endocrine disruptors. There are a few, not that many actually. A few are approved even, there are some under review. But I think as a community here, we really have to work together here. It's regulators, it's industry, it's the scientists. It's an opportunity to put these forces together and then develop something that would have really impact on regulation. This is my take-home message, really. We should do that and work much harder in this and create more AOPs. So I can get completely carried away about AOPs and people get a bit annoyed then, and you say, okay, how to kill the enthusiasm? And that's quite easy for me, or you can easily do it. It's just 2 letters. Classification and labeling, what about that? You cannot classify based on in vitro and QSARs or whatever. We need those animal studies. We cannot determine anything about that, and we are obliged to do that. And what is it really we do? Come on. So here's a very famous example from a famous compound, glyphosate. So we have a lot of carcinogenicity studies, we've discussed a lot about, you know, there's a few stars here in the high dose range and outside the historical controls. It's around 1,000 above 1,000 milligrams per kilo during the lifetime of these mice. This is the issue with glyphosate. We look at this. But should we really care about this? To be honest, my dears, I don't give a damn. But what should we do then? Should we just trash it and discard it? Maybe that's not such a stupid idea. The person who kind of voiced this and aided this is sitting in this room. Do you want to be acknowledged, Maurice? that we could just we step back and maybe we don't have to look at this so carefully. What is it really we should be concerned about? So we have another pesticide here. It's been run through the ToxCast program, the endocrine disruptive screening program, and there is not much is going on. We have another one here. This is firing up. It's very bioactive. We should look at these low dose activities, these potent compounds, these liabilities for nuclear receptors or whatever, mitochondrial toxicity. This is where, and sort that out. And then we don't have to worry about something might happening at doses 10,000 times higher. I think it's not useful for anybody. And we should really focus our work on these things. So here's an example. Triazole. This is something I would care about. It's a very nice little molecule. It's toxic to reproduction. There's some ED signaling activity. We don't know about DMT properties. We don't know about carcinogenicity. What's the sources? That's all these pesticides here. We also see it comes from biocides. This metabolite, we find it in food, in groundwater, other sources, and this was really a big surprise to me. Denitrification, that was a new word for me. So we use it in fertilizers. Yeah, we use it in fertilizers, and to avoid the formation of nitric oxide, this is a really good example of where we need to integrate it, because we are handling these different liabilities really differently. Sometimes we would think, for triazole, we sort it out in the pesticides, and we'll do the risk assessment, but here we apply a methodology which is just common risk assessment. Although it might be an endocrine disruptor, but the criteria for the endocrine disruptors is not taking care of the metabolites. So for the same liability, we have two different methodologies, risk assessment methodologies in Europe. And this is very, very difficult to explain to the public. So the compartments, the way to bridge that's really, this very cool regulatory tool. AOPs, and we can integrate. This is the mean how we can integrate all these different types of data, and put it into a regulatory context. And this is where we can go to a top-down approach. We did that for the Parkinson's disease, and where we developed an AOP. It was very useful. We could, by doing that, it occurred to us, or it was visible, that actually the way we do it with the animal testing now, it's not good enough. We are not doing the tests are not sensitive enough, and this is very useful. And of course the other way. So my holistic wish list is we have to do more screening. Think about just do the liabilities we are most concerned about. We have to develop AOPs. Data availability is a big issue here. We have to define the protection goals. We need flexible data requirements and, of course, harmonized approaches. So we can take what US is doing and vice versa and recognize that, and we don't have to do the work again. If you're more interested in, seeing more specific recommendations for the pesticide systems, there are these two new reports. There's the a big evidence review, and the European Commission, the scientific advice mechanism, they took some of the recommendations up to how to improve the pesticide regulation in Europe. And I'm finished with that. You can see more there, and now I'm done.
Thank you very much, Suzanne, for this passionate presentation and call for change. Time is really running. We are already 10 minutes into the coffee break, and you can hear the buzz outside. So I suggest we don't take any question now. We have finally managed to work with the app, so we have a good stock of questions, which we will take in the next talks and in the panel discussion. Thank you very much. We are back here at 10:30. Thanks.
The time has come when we may run to the hills, the mills, and search for a thing we call fun. We've got to get it on so we can live long, grow strong, and truly belong. To a race or equal, the creator will never, never need a sequel. So we ask you all to join us in a universal prayer for every man and woman.
Prince of Peace, watch.